anterior intraventricular groove. It's kind of filled with fat and blood vessels. I'll teach you the blood vessels coming up next. Like I said earlier, if you can identify it, you've got the front, you've got the right, and the left ventricles already identified by default. Okay, that's the first thing you look for. Then, once you figure out, okay, this is the front, that's the correct groove, it looks like that, and now look for the first artery. The pulmonary trunk is the most anterior artery. It's probably the first one you'll see in your sheep heart. Pulmonary trunk. It's the most anterior artery. Okay. And how you can check yourself if you don't think it's the pulmonary trunk, you think it's the aorta. Take a metal probe, stick it down the cut artery, and see which ventricle it goes to. If you think it's the pulmonary trunk and you stick your probe down it, what ventricle should it end up in? The RV. So you should kind of poke around there and see. Well, the question becomes, can you identify the RV? It's right here. So if you stick a probe down there and start poking around, oh yeah, you're in the right chamber. So you know it's the right artery. Also, do you see how, like, in this plane, you see these two Dumbo ears? Remember, what's the word? Auricle, right? So look for right and left auricle. When they're in the same funnel plane here, that's pretty much the anterior surface. Look for the auricles. Right, left, auricles. Remember, the auricles are a part of the atria. They're the Dumbo ear part that fills with blood. They expand to fill with blood during diastole. It's what we said earlier. And I think it's good to find the auricles because a lot of students confuse atria for ventricles. But once you find the auricles are the atria, right? They're a part of it. They're one and the same. So that way you won't confuse atria from ventricles. Also from the anterior view, try to find ligamentum arteriosum. It's between pulmonary trunk and aorta. Aorta. So to find that structure, you need to find pulmonary trunk and aorta, and then just start to pull them apart and look in between, see if you can see something that looks like a ligament between the two. Those are the basic things to look for on the anterior surface. Here's a picture of the anterior surface next to the small heart on the stand. And if you want to have the model while you're doing your sheep heart dissection, that can be helpful too. Here's a picture of ligamentum arteriosum from a student dissection. It was like the best one I've seen. I usually don't see it this obvious, but the arrow's pointing to it. You're just looking for a structure between pulmonary trunk and aorta. I know it might be hard to see here. It's all zoomed in and a bit blurry. Identify this vessel here. That's the pulmonary trunk. That's the aorta. Okay, that branch coming out there is the brachial cephalic artery. I haven't taught that yet, but we'll get there. Here's a posterior view of the heart. Now remember, the atria are behind the ventricles. So when you look posteriorly, that's kind of what you see in our models there, right? So, identify chamber. The left atrium. The right atrium. That's pretty much what you see posteriorly, I would say. Here's a picture of the posterior view of the other part we have. Here's a diaphragmatic view, the inferior view. Okay, we still see the atria on top. Left atria, right atria. on the monitor here. Here's the left atria, here's the right atria. Okay, in the model they use blue to symbolize deoxygenated blood. Identify 60. Inferior vena cava. The superior is going to be up there. See, this matches that. It's the inferior vena cava. You know, and on yours, it's not going to be a big, obvious blue tube. Blood vessels on a real organ, they look whitish, grayish. Arteries are usually a little more whitish and pinkish. Well, you just have to see tomorrow. Don't write those colors down. But it's not obvious. And the walls are very thin. So it's like you kind of have to like poke around and look for a hole right around here. And you can stick your probe all the way up through the superior vena cava. Okay? And you can even cut through the length of your probe as it's in there to visualize the inside. What you see posteriorly, inferiorly right here, is a posterior interventricular groove, okay? Put that down. So for an inferior aspect, look for posterior groove, or a groove is a sulcus. If a book calls it sulcus, same thing as a groove. Okay. Notice there's a groove dividing the atria from the ventricles. It goes around this way. Okay. The posterior interventricular groove goes in this orientation, up and down. In this way, going around, it's the coronary sulcus, okay? You see it best from this perspective. It goes all the way around, but you see it best right here. And the structure line in it, between atria on top and ventricles on the bottom, is the coronary sinus, a blood vessel that lies in the coronary sulcus. Sinus. It functions as a vein. It functions as a vein. So it's draining deoxygenated blood from the myocardium to the right atrium to be recirculated. Okay? So as we look at it here, blood is flowing, I guess, this way, right into the right atrium. Those are the views of the heart. Any questions? Again, I said this earlier, I'll say it again. It was number 34. It's hard to find on the sheet part. Usually what I would like students to do to identify it is I say, I'm going to come around, I'm going to check you up, be checking you off, I'll check off all these things. The last page of your dissection, look at it. It's just a checkoff page. That's how I assess students that you know what you're looking at. The hardest one is this one, the coronary sinus. I'll tell you to put your probe in it. So you have to like have the right atrium open, and you have to get your probe, and you have to find this opening, and literally stick your probe inside that sinus. Okay? It's very difficult to do without guidance, and I'm here to help you, but I'd be impressed if you could do it without any help from me, if you could just find it on your own. That's a tough one. So again, in a dissection, we like to cut an opening. So when you cut open the right atrium, remember to look for the structures we noted earlier. What's the name of the comb-like appearance? Not chordae tendinae. Pectinate. That's the one that means comb-like appearance. I'll ask you to see the pectinate muscle. Remember, it's on the inside of the auricles. And sometimes that's hard to find. And do you ever like, I don't know, as a kid, invert your eyelids? Okay. Don't do that, but I'll ask you to invert the auricle. Okay, take the auricle and turn it inside out, and you'll get a good view of the pectinate muscle. Here's the here's a, let's see, here's right atrium. Yeah, here's the right ventricle. Usually what I tell students to do on the in the instructions is, if you can locate the this interventricular groove or sulcus, if you just kind of take your scissors and just find the pulmonary trunk and just cut all the way down following the anterior interventricular sulcus, maybe stay a centimeter to this side of it and just kind of cut up here. That way you get a good view in here. So if this is the right ventricle, what valve is that? Tricuspid valve. Well, the heartstrings, the chordae tendineae, and the papillary muscle. Okay. Therefore, what is this valve or this valve? Pulmonary semilunar. Okay, that's the pulmonary trunk, pulmonary semilunar valve. That's kind of what I want you to see and look for inside there. I'll ask you to point out the trabeculae carnae, the crossbars of flesh, and just find any part where, in your sheep part, it looks kind of rough. The muscle looks rough, not smooth. I'm gonna need the lights off, and it's a little better. Here's the left side of the heart. The left and the right, they look different. And if this is the left side of the heart, what chamber is that? Left atrium, blood flows forward to the left ventricle, and it's going to go up there. That's the aortic valve up there. It's out of sight. But these are the chordae tendineae. So what valve, cusp of what valve would that be? Not, that's not semilunar. It's either going to be, you can call it bicuspid or mitral. And but the semilunar valve is up there. It's out of sight, the aortic valve. Well, if this is the left atria, I see two red holes. What are they trying to model there? Red pulmonary veins carrying oxygenated blood. Okay. Now that's the wall of the left atrium open there, but it looks like someone combed that. What do you call it? That's the pectinate on the left atrium. You have it on the right one too. It's modeled the same way. I mean, the pictures and the models, they're hand in hand. So you can study the pictures at home, and just like you're studying this right here. Here's the bicuspid valve, here's the pectinate, trabeculae carinae, all the same stuff. What is this right here? We're looking at it earlier. Ligamentum.
Ligamentum
arteriosum. Yeah, arteriosum, very good. Moving on. I want to teach the aorta in more detail. I haven't done that yet. The aorta has a bunch of different names. It kind of drives students crazy, but you need the names, because if you just say aorta, you don't know where in the body you're talking about. So the artery doesn't change just the name to tell you where you are relative to the heart. So we have to know this main artery connected to the heart and some of the branches, because this artery is distributing blood to the whole body. We got a lateral view here. Here's the heart. The first part of the aorta coming off the left ventricle, they just call it the ascending aorta. It's at about the level of your sternal angle, right there. About the first 2.5 centimeters coming off the heart. Off LV, the left ventricle. Now that's what it's receiving blood from if the aortic valve is open. Then it arches up and down. Okay, and it's kind of at the level of T4 vertebra, if you count your vertebra. I know that's T1 because that's rib 1, so T1, 2, 3, 4. So around T4, it begins and ends at the level of T4 vertebra. Aortic arch. Begins and ends at the level of T4 vertebra. So after that, the name of the artery, just call it descending or thoracic aorta because it's in the thoracic cavity and blood is descending in it. So call it from there to there. That's about T4 to around T12. Call it descending aorta. Or thoracic aorta runs from T4 to T12. Now once it goes to T12, it goes through the aortic hiatus and the diaphragm becomes the abdominal aorta. But I'll teach abdominal aorta when we get to the digestive viscera. For now, we'll just kind of stop at thoracic aorta. Now, all along the way, it's giving off branches to supply blood to different things. And when you talk about arteries, because you're distributing blood, it starts here and distributes out, and it gives off all these branches, like when a tree trunk grows and gives off branches, it branches out, right, from the trunk. It's kind of the same analogy here for blood vessels. You branch out from the aorta. So arteries branch. As a concept, quote unquote, branch. It's like blood is flowing from some larger vessel but this little branch, if the branch is open, blood flows out to the little branch. Sometimes they call arteries branches. And that really confuses students. I thought it was an artery. Well, sometimes they call it branches. Now for veins, veins don't branch. Okay, so don't call veins branches. For veins, blood is flowing in the opposite way. Veins are next to arteries all the time, but blood is flowing in opposite directions. So, because one is distributing blood and one is returning blood. So in this big one, maybe blood is flowing this way. And all these little tributaries are draining into the bigger one. So veins are called tributaries, if you ever see that term. Just don't call them branches. Okay, I just wanted to give that little spiel because I'm going to talk about the branches of these different parts of the aorta. Here's a picture of the ascending aorta. Okay, this structure right there. Let me point to something. See if you're with me. If this is the aorta, identify that valve. That should be the aortic semilunar valve, right? So literally, you're at the valve, and the first couple of centimeters, you're the ascending aorta. You already have branches coming off of you that will distribute blood to the myocardium. So this is the left and right coronary arteries. They supply blood to the heart muscle. So know those as the branches of ascending aorta. So you have left and right coronary arteries, which are the branches of the ascending aorta. We need to identify those. Then you have the aortic arch. Now the aortic arch has three main branches. And I have a couple of pictures here. It's hard to see the branches of the aortic arch with all the other stuff in the way. So study pictures like this, and it's shown easily on your heart. From right to left, the branches are brachiocephalic trunk, left common carotid, left subclavian. From right to left, the branches are brachiocephalic trunk. It's called trunk, it's an artery, okay? Left common carotid, and then left subclavian artery. It's spelled carotid, pronounced carotid, not sure why. And that's it, those three, know those, that's pretty basic stuff. So what you notice here is that those two arteries, the subclavian and the carotid arteries, those are big ones. They supply blood to head and neck and to the whole upper extremity. So it's different on the left and right sides. The ones on the left branch right off the aortic arch. But notice on the right side, the brachiocephalic trunk will give rise to the common carotid and the subclavian, okay? And again, why is that? Because remember, the aorta is a little bit on the left side. So to get to the right, it needs to extend this brachiocephalic trunk out the four branches, okay? So there's a difference from the left and the right side. All right, the branches of the thoracic aorta, there are many. I'll just have you know the branches that supply blood to the intercostal spaces for the ribs. So you kind of see them here. This picture shows it better. See how they're paired, because your ribs are paired? So those are cut branches from the posterior intercostal arteries. So know those as branches of thoracic aorta. So little a again is my abbreviation for arteries plural. Here's the full length of the thoracic aorta from about the level of T4, where aortic arch ends, blood will descend down. There's T12 as it goes through the aortic hiatus and becomes the abdominal aorta, which we'll worry about later. But you can see the paired branches, the posterior intercostal arteries on that picture. Let's move on to, I have coronary vessels next. I want you to be able to identify blood vessels that supply blood to the heart itself, the coronary arteries. Coronary means crown. Anyways, let's just list them here. Right coronary artery, left coronary artery, that's all I taught you so far. Those branch off of ascending aorta. First one's off there. So there are many. I only want you to know two branches of the RCA and two branches of the LCA. There's a right marginal artery, there's a posterior interventricular artery. Let me clear the board here. And then coming off the left coronary artery, there's circumflex, and there's anterior interventricular branch, or artery. That's four. So a little memory jogger, how I remember the branches, I remember my TA told this to me. Think politics. If you're on the right, you're stiff and militant, like military police, MP. If you're on the left, you probably live in the state of California. That's helped me remember the branches to this day, so maybe it'll help you too. Know these two and these two branches of right and left coronary artery. We'll talk about the veins. You have pictures in your book that kind of look like this. They're pretty good. I want to use the app to show you what the coronary arteries look like in isolation off of the heart. There's the coronary arteries all by themselves. Coronary means crown. If you look at it from the right view, does it look like a crown? Well, someone sure thought they did, and they called them that. So there's the anterior view. I'm going to highlight one. What I have highlighted in purple is just the left coronary artery. Look how short it is, because as soon as it branches, it ends. So let me kind of map this out for you. Remember, these branch off of ascending aorta. So imagine you have ascending aorta right around there. Okay. Branch coming off of it, it's kind of short, the LCA, the left coronary artery. Now, it's going to branch. One branch will go down the anterior interventricular sulcus, or groove, more or less. Like that. Okay, and that branch is called the left anterior descending or anterior and interventricular artery. It's called both. Let me highlight it. So it's highlighted in purple now. Here's left coronary artery. There's the branch right there. As soon as it branches, it ends. And now you call this branch left anterior descending, or anterior interventricular artery. An anatomist would more likely call it this. In clinical circles, they usually call it left anterior descending. Also called the widowmaker. I mean, if this artery gets clogged, there's a blood clot in there, the whole left heart muscle dies and the heart cannot sustain blood pressure. Hence, widowmaker. That would be a massive heart attack, basically. Alright, now the other branch, it goes around back there. It's called circumflex. Just kind of leave it like it was. All right, that's called circumflex branch. What it's going to do is it's going to branch off the LCA and it's going to go around and it's going to go basically behind the heart. So I'll call it number 4. thorax artery. So notice that the anterior interventricular artery lies in a groove or sulcus of the same name. The circumflex artery lies in the coronary sulcus. Coronary sulcus lies in coronary sulcus. Right, let's do the right coronary artery and its branches. The right coronary artery is much longer. There's the one on the left, it's very short. Here's the one on the right, it's longer. It wraps all the way around the coronary sinus, going all the way to the back. Okay, so. It'll wrap around the back and go all the way back there. That's one number five. Right coronary artery. The right coronary artery is much longer than the left coronary artery. So I'm writing much longer than LCA. Okay. That's a question on your study guide, and it's one I get asked all the time, because you forgot that. So which one's longer, the one on the right or the one on the left?
Right.
Yeah, RCA is longer. I'm going to ask you one more time. Which one's longer?
Right.
The right. That's kind of annoying, but trust me, someone's still going to ask me. try to remember that, okay? Okay, it's hard to see because the heart's not here, but imagine this is the right margin of the heart when you're looking at it from the front. So the artery that runs along the right margin of the heart is called the marginal artery, or the right marginal artery, which would be its full name. It's a very small one. Ooh, I think that's it. No, it's not it. It's this one there. Right marginal branch, here it is. On the right margin of the heart. So I'm going to draw it as just kind of following the right margin of the heart there. That's one number six. No, there's left marginal artery too, but you're not responsible for that one. Just know the right marginal artery is a branch of RCA. Now there's one running in the posterior interventricular groove. Groove or sulcus. Let's see if I can get it here. I think that's it. Here it is. The one in purple is the posterior interventricular artery, a branch of right coronary artery. So this is the posterior interventricular artery. Here's the anterior interventricular artery. So notice how those two arteries connect front to back. So on my picture here, I'm using dotted line, like if you're behind and you can't see it, like this one. I'm on number seven. Posterior interventricular artery lies in the posterior interventricular sulcus. The posterior anterior interventricular sulcus, they connect front to back, so it's like, it's kind of hard to see, so it's like, but everyone recognizes this familiar shape, which is not completely accurate for a heart, right? We're seeing the real heart. but you have an anterior and a posterior interventricular sulcus, and they connect front to back. You have a coronary sulcus going all the way around, separating atria from ventricles. Okay, that's basically what you got, this thing going front to back and around the top there. So the posterior interventricular artery, it will anastomose with the anterior interventricular artery right there at the apex of the heart. And yeah, those are the arteries I want you to know. Let's talk about the veins. I'm going to go back to the PowerPoint slides. The vein that runs with the anterior interventricular artery is the great cardiac vein. Note that. I'll just kind of draw it. There. Great cardiac vein. The vein that runs with the right marginal artery is the small cardiac vein. Just draw a blue line there. Small cardiac vein. Then the one in the back that runs with the posterior interventricular artery is the middle cardiac vein. Now all of those veins, there's more, but all of them, they're gonna like drain into a coronary sinus that runs in the coronary sulcus. I usually see it on the back. It's gonna usually like on the back of the heart going into the right atrium there. So and let me just note it, coronary sinus. All veins drain to the coronary sinus. And notice they're called cardiac veins, not coronary veins. That's usually the term that's used. Here's a picture of the posterior view of the heart. Here's the coronary sinus. If I'm labeling it, because it's continuous with great cardiac vein here, I label it close to the right atrium. Because for sure that's when you start to call it the coronary sinus. Okay, so once again, to point out to the pictures, here is the anterior interventricular sulcus or groove, and you have the left anterior descending with great cardiac vein. Here is the right margin of the heart. So you have a small cardiac vein and a right marginal artery. But RCA is going to go all the way to the back of the heart, shown here. Here's the posterior interventricular sulcus. So you have the middle cardiac vein and the posterior interventricular branch. Back there. Okay, there's coronary sinus. And now you know the coronary vessels. So these are the arteries that supply blood to the heart. You ever hear of like I knew someone who had a quadruple bypass. What are they bypassing? They're bypassing a clot, a blockage in one of these main four arteries that I taught you. So if it's quadruple, it's probably the four I just taught you. Four branches I just taught you. I've seen hearts with a triple bypass. We have one out there, and I have to show it to you. A bypass is they have to take a blood vessel from another part of your body, so there's no tissue rejection, it's from your own body, and they'll graft it onto the artery where the blood's coming from, and it'll bypass, say the clot's here. So they'll graft it on here and they'll like bypass it and supply blood to the myocardium using the bypass graft. Hopefully you never need that one. Alright. Okay, I have some redundant slides here. I'm going to skip through these. I already taught this information. Let's skip to, if you're following me in the slides, where it says anatomy of the heart valves. So I want you to see something here. This is a very common picture in a lot of books. So let's orient ourselves. They basically chop the top off the heart in the exact plane of where the four heart valves are. So These are the semilunar valves. Well, I have them labeled. Notice that the pulmonary semilunar valve and the aortic semilunar valve, they're illustrated closed. And these valves, bicuspid and tricuspid, are illustrated open. This is the most anterior valve. How do you tell these two apart? One is look for the coronary arteries, the one on the left, and then the one on the right. See these little holes there? I want you to look for those holes. That's something I'll have you point out to me on your sheep heart. So imagine you're doing the dissection. This is the aorta. Just cut it off close to the valve and look for two little holes next to the cusps. These are the cusps of the valve. Okay, those are the openings of the coronary arteries. Now, one thing I wanted to point out, notice when the valve opens, do you see how the valve, it blocks the opening? Okay, so I just told you the opening is blocked. When the heart pumps blood, can the coronary artery receive blood?
No.
No. It's blocked by the valve. Okay, so the ironic thing is, when the heart is pumping blood to the whole body, it can't pump blood to itself. So what has to happen is, during diastole, the valve will close. Blood will actually start to flow backwards into the heart. But when the valve closes, that's when the coronary arteries can fill with blood. So that's something to note. Coronary arteries. Only receive blood during diastole. That's good. I think that's good for the heart. It receives its blood when it's relaxing, not contracting. It's a good time to get your blood when you're relaxed. All right, there's a picture of the pulmonary semilunar valve. These pictures aren't that great. I guess the one thing I want to remind you of when you show me these structures tomorrow on your sheet part is, when I ask you to point to a valve, point to a cusp. Okay. For example, this is bicuspid, because I want you to point to the cusp, that's the valve. The chordae tendineae and the papillary muscle are different structures, but they're all connected, so it gets a little confusing when you're in the sheep heart. So remember, when you identify valves, find the cusps. They're kind of hard to find. Sometimes on these semilunar valves, they're not obvious at all, and I kind of have to point it out to you that, oh, that's what they look like. And once you know what to look for, you do very well. I have three pictures here. This kind of gets us into the cardiac cycle for next time. I have this picture here. Think of the four valves in pairs. Two SL valves, two AV valves. Okay. Which two are open here? The two AV valves, right? Bicuspid and tricuspid. We can call them AV valves, atrioventricular valves for short. These are the two SL valves, semilunar valves for short. So during diastole, the heart is filling with blood. We call that the inflow phase. These valves are open, these valves are closed. Yeah.
How does the pulmonary and the aortic valve open and close? Do they have the coronary tendineae or no?
Oh, no, that's a good question. They don't need that. Basically, what opens the valves are the pressure from the ventricles. You squeeze the ventricles, you're squeezing the blood out of them. When you generate enough pressure, that open. So what opens them is pressure from the ventricles. Okay, now what closes them, when the heart relaxes, there's blood in these arteries. Blood actually starts to flow backwards, and it kind of like fills these little sinuses, and the weight of the blood closes the valve. Okay, so that's how they open and close. When you hear the heart through a stethoscope, the sounds you're hearing are the sound of valves closing. Not opening, they make noises when they close. We call that the lubbed up heart sounds. The first lub is the AV valve closing. The sharper dup sound are the semilunar valves closing. So for inflow, when you fill the heart with blood, you have two sets of valves, AV, SL. Again, for inflow, the AV valves are open. I'll put an O for open. I'll put an X for closed. You're filling the heart with blood, basically. All right? So the heart's relaxed. Do we call that diastole or systole?
Diastole.
Diastole. The pressure in the ventricles during diastole, it's super low. It's like less than 10. It's a really low number, basically. So that way blood from your veins can flow into the ventricles and fill them up. Now, when you're ready to pump, that's outflow. That's when the heart is in systole. Yeah.
What does SL stand for?
Semilunar. Remember, you have two semilunar valves, aortic and pulmonary. And just to make sure, he didn't ask, but what's AV stand for? Audiovisual? Atrioventricular in a cardiac lecture, right? These two valves, the bi and the tri. Or, I'm sorry, that's the tri and that's the bi. Tricuspid, bicuspid. Acceptable names are right AV valve and left AV valve.
Also, those are the
these two.
Yeah.
Very good. So, let me see if you're with me here. For the outflow picture, which valves are open, AV or SL?
SL.
Yeah. And the AV valves are closed, right? It reverses. Now, there are parts of the cardiac cycle where all four valves close. Let me ask you a question. If all four valves are closed, can you have inflow or outflow? That's a yes-no question.
No.
Blood can't flow in. These are closed. Blood can't flow out. These are closed. So those are very brief times in the cardiac cycle, but I'll address that in that lecture as well, basically. If you cut the heart in this plane, just totally cut it in half like that, and you're going to look at the shape of right ventricle, left ventricle. Again, the shapes are different. Okay? These ventricles aren't the same shape. When the heart's relaxed and dilated, they describe this shape as like a tube of toothpaste. When you squeeze the toothpaste, you squeeze the blood out. On the right ventricle, looks like they call it a billows, like you fan the flames with. But that's how you squeeze blood out of the heart and systole when it's contracting. Okay. So in your dissection tomorrow, we use a sheep heart to help students learn. I took a picture of this. It approximates the real human heart. That's the illustration we've been studying. You see the glistening appearance? I remember that's the visceral. Yeah, the visceral layer of the pericardium. There's a posterior view, and this might be good to like look at as you're doing the dissection. I have some things labeled there. Again, the first thing you want to find, can I tell the front from the back, right? Because there's the posterior interventricular sulcus or groove, and there's, once you find that, it's like your goal. You can see everything. Oh, there's the pulmonary trunk, the aorta. Everything you identify will be correct. Try to remember this for tomorrow. For the visceral pericardium, that's hard to do. So I kind of make that a bonus opportunity. I may give your group like one bonus point if you're able to do this or that. Another thing I haven't taught yet, but I'll have you look for it, are called Purkinje fibers. Purkinje fibers are modified muscle cells that conduct the electrical signal that makes the heart contract. and they're whitish fibers inside the ventricle. So make a note of that. If you could like see something that looks like this, that's not the chordate tendineae, they have the same appearance. I might give you another bonus point. Okay, something to look for. It's not gonna look this pretty.
What do they do?
They conduct the electrical signal.
Oh, yeah.
They conduct action potential. Okay, but that lecture, I haven't given it yet. All right. And for the rest of the time that remains, I'm going to give you time to study the R models. And I have your exams if you'd like to look at them. There's nothing to turn in for labs.